So it's important to be very careful about that. Okay? So if we were to think about Agile, you know, what it really is just a way of thinking and acting, which is, you know, what the Agile Manifesto brings onto the table. And what it tells is that the objective is to increase value to the customer. So if we were to see about lean thinking, then we also have a way of thinking and acting. And the focus is to optimize everything and to eliminate waste. That's the basic premise. And basically what we want to attain with this is high quality value. And this is very important. So in Lean, what we want to do is that we are going to focus on value where, you know, we are actually concentrating on quality. And there's a lot of discussion that can go about this. I actually could go through a very lengthy discussion on what value is and what quality is. But that's not the objective of this presentation. So let's just understand that what we want to make sure is that we shouldn't, even though we have, for example, time boxes in some of the methodologies, we should make sure that we don't stress on time. What we have to really put our finger on is on value, not on time. So it doesn't matter if it takes a little longer to get this one done, if it's going to provide better value to the customer. So basically, what does that mean? Well, you know, going to different conferences during the last, you know, 4 or 5 years, very often I hear people talk about why our adoption is failing. And they come up with these kind of reasons. So I'm pretty sure that you guys might have already discussed these ones. So I am not going to talk about that. You know, what I'm going to talk is about the fact that there are other important aspects that we have to pay attention to. And actually, I am absolutely convinced that they are way more important than those risks, okay? So the first one is what I call the Tin Man Syndrome. So what do I call it, the Tin Man Syndrome? Well, so you guys know the Wizard of Oz. You guys, I presume you are familiar with the Tin Man. So why do I call it this way? Well, because quite often, when a methodology is adopted, we focus on the mechanics of that methodology. We focus on, let's do this 2 week or 3 week iteration, and we're going to meet every morning, and I'm going to say what I did, what I'm doing, etc., etc., etc. And right away, as soon as we start working on that, we just focus on the mechanics of things. And we immediately lose attention to what really matters, which is that which is the agile thinking, or that which is the lean thinking, or the systems thinking. And that's actually what we should be paying attention to the most. And actually, you know, I will dare to say, you could actually, just by applying the thinking, forget about all the methodologies that exist out there, and you can still make a company much more successful than they currently are. You can actually bring them out of the hole if you just apply that. Because that allows you to bring a very deep understanding on what's going on, and it's going to help you be able to figure out better solutions to improve, you know, the situation of that company. And that also brings, into the discussion the concept of autonomation. Not automation, autonomation, okay? In Japanese, this is called jidoka, which is translated as autonomation. It has been translated also as automation with human touch. I don't quite like the translation. But basically what this is telling us is that we have to automate everything that we can. And then we have to try really hard to automate everything that apparently we couldn't automate. And the objective of doing this is to then be able to free people so that they can spend their time figuring out, identifying opportunities for improvement and figuring out how to make those improvements. So this is huge, right? Imagine, you know, not having to worry about constructing something and being able to focus about how to improve what is being done, you know, and how it is being done. So the human factor is key, okay? And by human factor, I don't mean the term human factor. I mean about, you know, the fact that of having human beings be utilized in what human beings are really good at. Okay. Actually, there's an old book, I don't remember the year, but it's very, very old. The author is Norbert Wiener. Norbert Wiener is the father of cybernetics. He wrote a book entitled The Human Use of Human Beings. It's the only book he wrote, out of the 4 or 5 he wrote, that is non-technical. It doesn't talk about control theory or anything like that. And I think it's the most valuable because he actually talks about what this is. So I highly recommend it. Another point is beware of the fashion trap, okay? I mean, just this morning I got an email from a person whom I was in contact some time ago, and hey, Masa, I just got a new job and we want to do like some innovative stuff. So we want to do Scrum. Can we talk about that and how we can bring Scrum? And I assure you, you know, if I were to call her and say, why do you want to do Scrum? They won't have a reason. I mean, they won't have a real reason. Well, everybody's doing it, right? So wait a second. I mean, if everybody jumps off the cliff, will you? Right? So be very careful. Don't just go and jump into a conclusion just because everybody is doing it. You have to really understand what the needs of your reality is to then determine what is that you're going to implement. I mean, it's a really, really great, but it's also, you know, there's risk involved and there's cost involved in doing a transformation. So if you're going to do it, congratulations, but do it right, okay? So don't do it just because everybody else is doing it. Another point is sticking to it. And what does this mean? Well, what this means is, here comes a customer, you know, with a need, and we say, oh yeah, we have a solution for you. And what's the solution? Well, there is one solution. And then another customer comes and says, hey, we have a problem, can we solve it? Yes, how are we gonna solve it? Well, we have a way to solve it. And here comes another one. And how are you going to solve it? Well, we have a great way to solve it. And what happens? Well, what happens is that we end up just falling into this famous, you know, metaphor of, you know, if you only have a hammer. And unfortunately, this happens way too often. So beware, there's no such a thing as a magic formula. Okay? So you have to figure out, and you have to have, you know, a really nice tool set so that you can identify and utilize that which really applies to provide the best value to the customer. Not that which just makes your life easier, or just because this is what I did before, then this is what I do again. So be very careful, okay? So using the same approach to different problems is not the best of ideas, okay? As it is practicing an agile methodology by the book. What do I mean? Well, don't just go on and be a verbatim, you know, real-life representation of what's written in a book. Just understand the context, figure out how you can actually use that knowledge and those skills in the way that best benefits, you know, the people who are doing the job and the people who are getting the benefit of, you know, what you are building. So here's an example. So this is a customer in the financial industry. I started working with them. They were so smart that they say, no coaching, just training. So I get the training, I go visit them a couple of months later, and this is their Scrum room. And I was like, wow, that's really cool. I don't even have to step in to know what happened. But anyway, so there's three charts over here, and I'm going to show you details. So here's the sprint one, here's the sprint two, and here's the sprint three. Do we need to say more? Okay, so what happened? Well, two things happened. One of them was, you know, oh, we can just do it. You know, this is just a mechanical thing. We just do, you know, the sprints and the meetings and whatever, and we're okay. We don't need coaching. And then what happens was also that what they did was they kept on doing the exact same thing they were doing before. They just started calling it differently, and they started trying to graph it, right? So be careful. So you have to consider what your context is, but also you have to acknowledge the fact, and by you in this case, I mean the customer, you know? They have to understand that it's not enough to just say, I'm going to go to the, you know, to the cheapest solution or the quickest one. But we should look after the right one, you know? So it's the difference between throughput accounting and cost accounting. You know, the difference between saying, I'm just going to spend the minimum and try to get the maximum, you know, versus saying we have to do the right thing to get the best possible value. Another point is flying on instruments. So everybody knows what this means, right? When you are, you know, you're flying an airplane, those of you who have done it, I'm sure you have had a lot of fun doing it. I did it once and it was fun. Basically, that's when you have zero visibility, either because it is nighttime or because, you know, there are too many clouds. Whichever weather condition, you just, you know, the windows are good for nothing, right? The windshields. So then you had to rely only on instrumentation to do your flying and, you know, your calculations and all that stuff. So this is what we do most times. We just go about starting to apply something without taking into account what's going on. And that's wrong. You know, what we have to do is we have to start applying systems thinking and lean thinking. And basically, we have to ask why. Why is it? So it's not only, okay, the customers want something, I'm going to do it. It's okay, why do you want it? You know, what's the benefit? What is it that you're looking for? You know, what are the different solutions that we can bring, and so on. So you have to really dig deep into the marrow of what it is that needs to be accomplished and why we want to accomplish it. So obviously we know very well that an advantage of bringing Agile is that, you know, these methodologies, and some more than others, bring visualization. And that visualization allows me to better understand what's going on. So if we have, for example, a Scrum board, we have a certain amount of visualization. But to be honest, we really don't know what's going on here. We know that people are working, but we don't know exactly what's going on. Therefore, we don't know if we can improve the actual process. Whereas if we apply something like Kanban, when we have Kanban, we have a high visualization because Kanban allows us to actually see every step of the process. And it allows us, through the visualization, determine in which way the behavior is helping us or not. And that invites us to then do something to improve it. And, so Henrik, you know, the talk right before this one, he mentioned about putting a whip limit on the doing column. Well, that's a way to start improving, you know, what's going on. But it will be much better if we actually granularize that part so that we can really see what's going on. And that will make things a lot better. And I put this one just for people who are not already familiar with Lean and Agile. And it's the fact that, you know, we rely on tools that are over 100 years old. You guys know, right? Gantt charts actually 102 years old already. And the current ones are exactly the same as the original ones, except that now they are electronic, but they are exactly the same thing. And I think it's ridiculous to not consider that in over 100 years there has to be a better way to measure and to manage. So the problem with this is that, you know, managers tend to get so into the tool. I know if it has happened to you that you go and you want to talk to your manager and say, hey, I have an issue. Don't bother me. I am updating my project. You know, I need to bring a report to the board of directors. So they are paying attention to the tool, so which means the tool knows a lot, but the manager doesn't really know how things are going. And what we have behind that is a lot of chaos. And we want to avoid that, right? So I need water. So basically, what we have to make sure is that we really pay attention to what's going on, okay? Pay attention to your customer. Listen, talk, converse, collaborate, communicate. It's super, super important for you guys to do that. You know, it's too arrogant for us to say, oh, we know what the value is. We can just do it. And it's equally arrogant for the customer to say, oh, I know what I want. I'll just tell you and you do it. We really have to go through a conversation of discovery to be able to identify what that true value is. And even doing that, you know, is risky. And another one, obviously, is ignoring problems. If I don't see it, I don't feel it, it didn't happen, it didn't exist, so it's okay. And then what happens? Well, it accumulates. And when it accumulates, it just gets worse over time. So instead of seeing these as, oh, these are problems, we could probably just like change the way we see it and say, these are opportunities of improvement. So when you do that, actually people feel attracted to it. You say, there's a problem. Oh no, ooh, you know, try to get away from it. But you say, this is an opportunity for improvement. Oh, let's check it out. Let's see what's going on. So just you know, the selection of words alone means a lot. And then infatuated with mythology. So everybody knows this, right? I need to mention what this is. But anyway, so, and there's this guy, well, there was, he passed away, his name is Joseph Campbell. He was a scholar who was, you know, very deep into religion and mythology as as something that has been evolved by, you know, by humans. And he wasn't looking at religion as such, but as a phenomenon of the, you know, the human interaction. And he wrote a book entitled The Hero of the Thousand Masks, if I remember correctly. And it just so happened that in that book he indicates what are those key aspects that are universal in humans that make of a hero a hero. And George Lucas actually took all the elements that are in that book and wrote Star Wars. And that's why Star Wars is so successful, because it's universal. It just follows exactly all those points that Joseph Campbell mentioned. And that's kind of cool. However, beware of the heroes, okay? And why do we want to beware of the heroes? Well, because the heroes tend to do more damage than good most of the time, you know? Why? Because everybody knows about firefighting. You know, something goes wrong and everybody gets into overdrive and let's try to solve the issue and we're working until 2, 3 a.m. Finally, we solve the problem and we high five and like, oh, this is great, we did it. And awesome. Why do we feel so euphoric after we do some firefighting? Because there's some adrenaline rush in the body. And one of the side effects of adrenaline is that you feel euphoric once, you know, the hormone starts fading away. And that's a sensation, is something that is pleasant, that is nice. So what happens is that we want more. Okay, so you start becoming addicted to that. That's why amusement parks, you know, the roller coasters are so successful, because we want that thrill. So the point with this is we all want to be heroes, okay? Most of us, when we were little, we wanted to be firefighters at some point. Why? Because firefighters are actually the ideal hero in the real world. They are not carrying guns. They are not, you know, pursuing villains. They are just doing nice things. You know, they're bringing the cat down from the tree, and they're, you know, extinguishing the fire and doing all those things. So we're like, wow, this is the ultimate hero. So we all want to do that. So when we do our firefighting, you know, at war, because there was a pretty ugly defect, then we fulfill that childhood dream. You know, I am a real life hero. And then that person within, which is typical, every company has it, and sometimes every team has it, this person is the one who solves every problem. Well, guess what? Subconsciously, this person is making it easy for fires to happen, because he wants to still be up there on a pedestal. So we had to change the mindset. Amongst other things, why? Well, even though firefighters are the ultimate hero, what happens when there's a fire and the firefighters come to extinguish it? Well, the result is something like this. Ta-da! So the house is destroyed, we extinguish the fire, but the house is destroyed. And hey, look, we rescue a family photo. Wow! So what happens with the work we're doing? Well, we're writing code, pretty crappy, and then we have all these problems, we extinguish the fire, what's the result? So we had to think about it from the standpoint of quality, of productivity, economics. So this is not a good idea. So we shouldn't become really good at firefighting. Actually, we should become really good at writing fireproof code. That's what we should do. We should encourage that. And we should figure out a way to have those ultimate heroes change the way they work so that they actually become heroes in making sure that, there's been a year and not a single fire. That will be an achievement. Okay? So basically what I'm trying to say is this way of thinking and operating is non-value added work, meaning is waste. And then we have the multitasker. So we have this tendency to admire people who can do a lot of things at the same time. I'm working on 5 projects at the same time, and I'm really good, and wow, I know how you do it, but when I grow up, I want to be like you, right? Not really. Why? Because when we multitask, we actually waste a lot of time. There's hard data that demonstrate that task switching in knowledge work takes between 15 minutes and 30 minutes. So imagine if a person is working on 5 projects every day, that means 4 task switches, which are depending on, let's say we go to both limits, 15 minutes or 30 minutes, we're talking between 1 and 2 hours of waste per day, which translates into 5 hours to 10 hours of waste per week. And the people are complaining that they're burning out because they're working long hours, they come on Saturdays. Well, guess what, you know? So your strategy of multitasking is actually backfiring you. So don't do it, okay? So don't do task switching. And then come the disciplines. So the disciplines, I am of Japanese Mexican descendants. My education was very strongly influenced by the Japanese way of doing things, and I lived in Japan 6 years. Something that to me was pretty amazing is, you know, this balance when you consider that there's very small spaces, but the way they use spaces is pretty awesome. You have actually empty spaces. So you have these very simple rooms, and say, well, how do they do it? How is it that we can have something so narrow, so small, and yet so beautiful and so spacious? When we human beings naturally have a tendency to fill spaces, you rent an apartment. 6 months later, you cannot fit in. You have to rent a larger apartment. It gets full with, you know, stuff and a half, and so on. So this is very important because we have to understand that empty spaces are a good thing. What does that mean? What that means is that we shouldn't fill people at 100% capacity. This means we should allow them to have the opportunity to just slow down, think carefully what they're doing, figure out a better way to do what they're doing, etc. This is very, very important, and we should be doing this also towards ourselves. So we have to allow autonomy, and within that autonomy, we have to allow people to just really be creative and do the best of their own work. And as we increase discipline in the team and we increase confidence in the team, they're going to be more efficient. Another point is this. Way back when I had, like, you know, probably like 20 pounds less of weight than what I have now, I used to be a climber, and actually I used to be a very accomplished climber. I did first climbs and, you know, some pretty challenging walls, pretty cool walls in the planet. And ice climbing was one of my favorite activities. Well, it still is, but I don't do it anymore. I can barely climb the stairs. But something that was very important about this is the more difficult the climb, basically what you had to do is you had your tools, you had these two spikes on your hands and your feet, and you had to, instead of just like going fast and, you know, no, what you had to do is the more difficult the climb is, you had to actually slow down. And what you had to do is you place your tools, and you have 3 points that are static and only one moves. So I either have both feet and one hand, you know, static, and then I place the other hand, or I have both hands and one foot, and then move the other one. And you just go very slowly, and actually you move very slowly to keep balance on what you're doing. If you try to move quick, you lose balance and you fall. And, well, needless to say more, right? What happens if you fall? So what this means is, make sure to just do things at the right speed, at the right pace. Don't force yourself to go too quick or too slow. Just do it at the pace that is right for you, the pace that is going to allow you to actually create value and not create waste. Okay? And then we have traffic. There's no traffic here, right? We just went to a Tok Tok ride the other day, and it was pretty amazing, you know, to see that there is actually no distance between the Tok Toks and the... You had the wheel of this truck, like, right next to you. You know, it's pretty amazing. But anyway, so... But we're alive. We made it. all day, and there was not a single accident, which was even more surprising. But what is important here is we have to understand that if we try to work things out at maximum capacity, we are not going to get a good outcome. You know, there's actually a model that shows the relationship between density, time, and flow. And what it shows to us is that if we have way too many cars in the highway or way too few cars in the highway, then the flow is less efficient. Why? Because when there's a lot of cars, then we have traffic. When there are too few cars, there is less flow. So when we're going too fast, there is less flow because obviously you're going way fast and you tend to leave more distance between you and the guy ahead of you so that you have time to react. So then density goes down. So you have to find the right level of density that is going to maximize the utilization of your system. And that's what we call limiting the work in progress. Okay? So, you know, the Agile methodologies don't have this. The only WIP we see is in Scrum. In Scrum, the only WIP that you have is the number of cards or user stories at your sprint backlog at the beginning of the sprint. But you don't have an actual WIP to control the flow throughout the system. And we want to do that to improve it. And last but not least, it's actually 304. It's just the fact that we have to be very adaptive. We have to learn that if we want to actually succeed, we have to be as flexible as possible. And we have to be evolutionary. I'm actually very pleasantly surprised by, you know, how things are going here at the conference. There's a lot of talking about Agile, about Lean, about Kanban, about systems thinking. And that's really cool. I have seen at other locations a lot of discussion about people saying, oh no, Lean is not Agile, so we do not accept it. Kanban is not an Agile methodology, so we do not accept it. You know, PMI has nothing to do with what we're doing here related to Agile. I was like, wait a second. PMI has embraced Agile, and you guys are not willing to embrace the other. So let's make sure not to do that. And I feel like I am just like preaching to the choir here, because I don't see that here, you know, but it's part of the presentation. So, okay, a little bit late from the actual schedule, but thank you, guys. If you have questions, we can talk outside. Okay. Thanks.